timing will be approximately that will take care of the CalWORKs proposals between now and 12:30, break for an hour for lunch, reconvene at 1:30, and get through the second half of the agenda with regards to child care, and then leave an hour for public comment between 3 and 4, concluding at that time. So that's the rough schedule. I ask you to bear with us, but we'll try and stay on course best that we can. And clearly, these proposals of the governor, in many cases very bold, not only in the cuts as suggested, but also in the programmatic changes as well, come at a very difficult time, couldn't come at a more difficult time. A lot of families, a lot of single parent families, a lot of children already suffering significantly because of the downturn in the economy, coupled with the very significant cuts that we've already made to so many of these programs since 2008. So recognizing that there are no easy solutions, I really want to encourage everyone, from administrators to providers to program participants to consumers, to offer us your ideas so that we can be as best informed as possible as we work our way through this process and then finally make our decisions. And keep in mind that today's conversation is just the beginning, in that our budget subcommittees will be doing their work in the coming weeks of March. So this is just an overview hearing, but we want to hear from the administration, of course, to lay out the proposals as we've done in past weeks with education and healthcare, and hear the analysis from the LAO, and then hear from all of you as to what your experiences and expertise can lend us in our decision making. So with that, we will begin with the setting of the context, and I want to ask Sarah Bond, Jean Ross, and Professor Jill Durberic to join us so we can have a look at what actually has been impacted as a result of the global fiscal crisis of 2008. We start with the Public Policy Institute.
Thank you, Senator Leno.
I want to make sure there you go. The red button is on.
Okay.
Yes.
Great. My name is Sarah Bone. I'm an economist at the Public Policy Institute of California. And I thank you very much for inviting me to help set the context for this important conversation. I'm going to discuss the impact of the Great Recession on families in California in terms of their income and employment. I'll provide some basic facts and briefly discuss the implications for California going forward. And much of the data that I'll discuss today comes from a report published by PPIC in December titled The Great Recession and Distribution of Income in California, which I think was given to you just now. It's co-authored by myself and Eric Schiff. So first I'll discuss how income has changed in the past few years. Family income has declined across the spectrum from the high end to the low end, but the declines for families at the low end of the income distribution were the steepest. The Great Recession officially spanned December 2007 through June 2009, but as you can see in this first chart, the impacts on income continued well beyond. The most recent Census Bureau data that we have for comprehensively looking at family income is for the full year 2010. And you can see that incomes declined across the board through that year. Total income for the median family in California fell more than 5% during the official years of the Great Recession, and in the year following, so through 2010, fell another 5% for a total of a 10% loss at the median. And this brought the median family to earning about $61,000 in 2010. That's the equivalent for a family of four. That's about the same as the median was in 1980. At the low end of the spectrum, so the green line, you can see that the declines were even larger during the recession and in the year following, so 21% total decline. And at the high end of the income distribution, incomes fell as well, but by less, a total of 5%. These across-the-board declines in family income are not surprising given the state of our economy and in particular the state of our labor market. As of course you know, unemployment and the duration of unemployment reached record highs during the Great Recession. And we've begun to see some turnaround in the labor market. The trend at least seems to have reversed itself, and we're seeing month-to-month improvements in the unemployment rate and in job growth. But we still face a jobs gap in California of about roughly 1.5 million jobs, which is the gap that we need to close in order to make up for the jobs lost, as well as account for new entrants to the labor market. And various estimates suggest that it will take another 5 to 12 years to close that gap, depending on how optimistic you want to be in projecting the scenario. But even the reversal in the trend and the positive signs that we're seeing in the labor market are not likely shared across the income distribution in the state. Labor market conditions have been most severe for least educated and lowest income families. And whereas we see the unemployment rate turning around for high and middle income workers, so the bottom three lines in this chart, you can see the trend in unemployment rate has reversed through 2011 for those middle and above middle income workers. But for the low income workers and low to middle income workers, we don't see any reversal yet in the trend towards increasing unemployment rates. And so without a reversal in labor market trends for these lowest income workers in our state, it's unlikely that we're going to see incomes at the low end of the spectrum picking back up very quickly. I'd like to note just quickly that we have also not seen strong indicators of a reversal in underemployment indicators, which has been another hallmark of this recession, that people are not just out of work, but those who are working fewer hours or working part-time. And particularly for low-income workers, we haven't seen a reversal in that trend. Now I'm going to talk about the overall impact of these changes. Oh, sorry, the title is cut off a bit. It should be clear on your handout. The gap between upper and low income workers, families, in California is now wider than ever. That's what this first red bar is showing. The gap is about twice what it was in 1980. And it's a bit larger than it is in the rest of the country. Furthermore, the percentage of families that I define as middle income in the state is shrinking to a new low, and that is just below a majority in 2010. In fact, if you look at the percentage of families who are considered low income and middle income, there's not really that much difference by 2010. This is a result of the recession, of course, as well as a result of long-term transitions in our economy, which have tended to favor high-skilled workers. So what can we expect in the future? Through 2010, there's no major evidence in recovery in terms of family income that we've seen yet. But as more data becomes available on how families' incomes are rebounding, given labor market improvements, we will see some improvement in some of these measures that I've presented. However, based on previous patterns, we don't expect that this recovery is going to be shared equally across the income distribution. If previous patterns persist, we can expect that families at the low end of the income distribution will recover much more slowly than those at the high end. In fact, low-income families in California have never fully recovered from the boom and bust cycles over the last 30 years, so that by 2010, they're actually earning 10 to 20% less than they were in 1980. Whereas at the top end of the income distribution, you see families take hits in terms of income during recessions, but then recover quite quickly and return to strong growth, meaning that even during the recession, they're earning 20 to 30% more than they were in 1980. So the disparity between high and low incomes in the state is likely to persist. And this, as I mentioned earlier, reflects long-term underlying economic trends that favor skilled workers, as well as the current recession. In the short term, job creation and overall economic growth will help boost family income. But the extremes that we're at in terms of the income distribution also raise longer-term questions about economic opportunity in California and whether it's shared equally across the spectrum. This is where I believe policy has an important role to play in creating economic opportunity so that middle and low-income workers in the state are not left behind. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Bowen, since we're going through so much detailed data. I'm going to suggest that we might ask you a few questions along the way rather than wait till we get to the end of the entire presentation. I have a couple that come to mind just from what you shared with us now. Looking at your slide that is headed Incomes Fell in the Great Recession Across the Spectrum, that's the one. You had told us that the 61,000 figure for the median income, it was last seen, I would imagine this is in constant dollars, 1980. Do we know the last time that for the 90th percentile, the 179,000 was as low as that? I guess just looking at it, I could see somewhere maybe a little,
for the 90th,
somewhere in 2004.
For the 90th percentile?
Yeah.
Right.
So and then the next question would be, when's the last time that the median income for the 10th percentile was 15,000?
Great questions. So at the top end, the level that the 90th percentile family is at in 2010 was last seen about
2004. I can see it on
the 2004, chart, yeah. And not really much before that. It's been a pretty continual strong growth for the top end of the distribution. You can see a bit more detail on this in Figure 1 of the report. At the low end of the spectrum, the 10th percentile hit the $15,000 annual income mark also around the late 90s as a result of that recession, and also in the early 90s. The 10th percentile of income actually might have been a bit lower than it is now back in the mid to early 1990s.
Okay. So it does underscore your point that the loss of middle class is, or middle wage earners, has been most significant, and that 61,000, you have to go all the way back to 1980 to get that low for that category.
That's right.
On your slide that is entitled Less Than the Majority of Californians Are Middle Income by 2010, on the far right, you show that the middle income group for the first, or at least in recent years, couple of decades, is below 50%. Do we know the last time it was below 50%?
In the data that we have that goes back to 1969, we haven't seen a rate this low.
So since 1969, we've not seen middle below 50%.
Correct, by our definition.
So then my last question would be, given current tax rates and other existing policies, do rising tides lift all boats, or are we just going to see this locked in right now until we make some policy changes?
I think we will see some small improvement in these kind of metrics as the recovery unfolds. But we're looking at the long-term transitions that over three decades and probably longer, four decades. I wish we had more data going back historically. But we've been seeing a shrinking continually over the last three decades at least. And that is not just because of taxes. It's among economists, there's some not entirely clear consensus, but the majority of economists, I think, believe that it's really technological change and economic trends like globalization that have really brought about these shifts that really favor skilled workers who use technology, and that technology replaces some of the jobs of what used to be good middle income jobs or good even lower middle income jobs. And so the rising tide, I would say, of technological change and globalization, which are good things in the sense that they enlarge the economic pie that we can all share, hasn't really been shared equally across the distribution. So I would say that, in fact, the changes haven't lifted all boats over the last three decades. That's what the data shows.
Most of the reports I've read show that this exponential growth in the disparity of incomes is a phenomenon recent to about 1975.
Mm-hmm. I think that's about right. Yeah, when we start looking at different kinds of changes that we've experienced, a lot of it dates to the mid-70s, early 80s, a lot of the fast transitions that we've experienced.
And I know that this panel is looking at the impacts of poverty and lower wage workers. I also just want to point out some of the ramifications of this growing disparity, in that we have a middle wage category below 50% for the first time, that so much of the growth of our economy in the 20th century, given that 70% of our entire economy is dependent upon consumer spending,
exactly,
that with an ever-shrinking middle class with fewer dollars to spend, it doesn't bode well for the greater economy.
That's precisely one of the key concerns that economists have about the shrinking middle class, is the consumer demand, which drives our economy. And it's perhaps a reason why we're in a slow recovery period, because the middle income consumers just don't have the income to spend as they were before.
One last question, and then colleagues, I'm sure, have all the questions. After World War II, we saw great growth in our economy, and a lot of it was relative to modernization of factories and our ability to increase our productivity, and that played well for the growth of middle class. You're talking now about a new generation of technological change, which by its very nature demands even higher skilled and educated workers than those who were working in factories. How do we build a middle class in recognition that this new technology is getting ever more technical and doesn't seem to benefit a large middle class?
Right. I can't say for sure, but the clearest policy action for me is educational, promoting educational attainment across the spectrum. Right now, that could be focused on retraining adult workers for the new technical good jobs of today. But in the long term, because we don't know what the next good middle income job is going to be, say in 10, 20 years, as you said, the rate of progress is so fast and we don't know where what the next good job might be, it's a good idea to just promote education overall, maybe particularly in math and sciences, but I think overall educational attainment so that workers across the income spectrum can have just the training that they need for whatever the next good job is. So I would make a case for general promotion rather than focusing on a specific
industry.
And
that's a great segue for where we're moving into, is how do we make sure our youngest are prepared to succeed in an educational environment and all the different components that get them to school prepared to succeed. Mm-hmm. And then just lastly, I'm reminded of some comments made by President Obama at Master Lock Factory in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, which is my hometown, and I grew up with kids whose family owned that Master Lock company, at least back then, that there are changes in the global economy now that are encouraging, from a fiscal point of view, factory owners to insource, was the president's term, bringing jobs back from China because wages are rising so quickly there and other conditions, that there may be things that we don't know about yet that are really going to drive jobs back here in the manufacturing sector. We just don't know. Senator Lowenthal and then Senator Evans.
I guess what strikes the first question, I'll make a statement. I mean, I think the what we're saying is that to be competitive now in a global economy, we really have to, just like in the 1960s, had said where our national attention was going to be focused on going to space, as the president. I think what we're also saying here is we have to ensure everybody is a skilled worker in this country. That's it. Everybody is a skilled worker. It's lifetime. First it was just the lower income folks who were getting passed by. Now it's the middle income. It's not something that you can paper over. It's a national issue that must be addressed. That is our jobs creator. We don't have to figure out that we have, and especially where I'm coming from, the focus in California must be on the community colleges, which have the largest number of trying to reach out to those, obviously K through 12, preschool, all. But we have to do a better job, and we have to have everyone participating in this process, and it has to be seen. And I don't see how we get out of it when we have such a large percentage of our population without the skills to function And we're not really equipped yet to deal with that as a society, because that's our crisis as a society. How do we definitely increase that into those numbers? Where these numbers are not going to go away. They're going to get worse, and it's going to go right through the middle class, which also does not have those skills. And so it's not just, I mean, we have to figure out how we're going to provide educational opportunities for everyone and hold people accountable and make sure it works.
Thank you, Senator Loco. I'm not going to call you a snob. We're going to move on to Senator Evans, Senator Hancock, Senator Everson, and Senator Olquist.
Senator Lowenthal, when you were talking, I saw a lot of hand signals from the audience indicating agreement. He's nice. I want to raise a little bit different issue, and one that I'd really appreciate comments from the panels as we go along today. Later on in the hearing, we're going to be talking about CalWORKs and child care proposals from the governor and ways in which he's finding some savings. And we know that as far as adult recipients from both of those programs, they're mainly single mothers. And one of the things as the chair of the Legislative Women's Caucus that we're always looking at is the impact of budget cuts over the past few years on women in our population. And it's actually women and children that are taking the brunt of most of these budget cuts and losing not only programs that have been serving them, but also losing their jobs as a result of cutting those programs. So with respect to this presentation, I'm wondering, did you look at the data, men versus women, any gender-based analysis?
Unfortunately for this study, we did not. There were so many different cuts that we wanted to do and keep it somewhat concise. We did look at how families of different makeup fared during the recession, so looking at married families, married with children, single parents with children. And you see, as you would expect, that incomes for the single with children families were much lower than they were for married families, either with or without children. And they took some of the steeper losses during the recession. That's as close as I can really get to answer your question.
Thank you, Senator Everson, Senator Hancock, and then Senator Emerson and Olquist.
Yeah. I'm struck that we're discussing the fact that technological change and globalization are removing jobs from the job market. One of the things that's of concern to me, and I wonder if any of you have thought about it, and maybe the other speakers could address it if they have, if everyone is a skilled worker, as Senator Lowenthal suggests, is there enough for them to do? And I say this because about 20 years ago, a very excellent economist said to me, the day will come when the allocation of work will be the topic. How do you keep adult human beings occupied so they don't get into trouble and give them the income so they can support themselves in a world where machines can do more and more and more? Now, obviously, there are some things that we could have really lower class size and educate everyone so they'd be not only a skilled worker but a human being that felt cared for. That would be a public sector expansion, not a private sector expansion. So just really, what is the future of work as we try to deal with the immediate crisis that without a good education and high skills, you don't have much chance?
First, I wanted to suggest that technological progress and globalization, I would argue, have actually increased the size of the economic pie and have not really taken away jobs on net. They have definitely improved outcomes for some workers and opportunities for some workers while diminishing those for others, but I think on net it's been a positive. As you can see from the chart that we're on right now, between 1990 and 2000, actually, it was what I would characterize as a net improvement in how families in California could be characterized in terms of low, middle, and high income. You see, the share of families that are low and middle income actually shrunk a little bit, and the growth happened among families considered high income. So that was a net improvement over the 1990s. What we see going into 2010 is that the Great Recession at least temporarily reversed that, and we saw a shift towards low income as families' incomes across the board were hit. So I would suggest that the issue is how we make sure that the economic gains due to the global economy and technological progress are shared equally across the distribution, particularly through education. And I think it would be great if we could educate everybody to be a skilled worker, although skilled workers earn more and demand services and demand a lot of products that are not all, do not all require high-skilled workers to complete them. So I think there will always be some mix of jobs demanded by the economy, but we can figure ways to make sure that those economic gains are more equally shared, at least, than they are now.
Senator Emerson.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, Senator Leno brought up the point that post-World War II, we saw a huge increase in manufacturing in California, and there's a relationship between manufacturing and middle-class jobs. And I presume that since the 1960s or late 60s, we've seen a decline in manufacturing in California to the point at which we're one of the lowest manufacturing states in the nation today. So is there a correlation between manufacturing jobs and what we're seeing with the middle class in your study?
Certainly. I don't directly identify that in this study, but other studies have made the connection between the decline in manufacturing across the board and the really hollowing out of opportunities for middle-income workers, those good middle-class jobs that people refer to. A lot of them were in manufacturing. I think there still are good manufacturing jobs for workers. They're just of a different sort, slightly more technical, more skilled, and there's fewer of them. Maybe there will be a new manufacturing some new high-tech product that will grow and demand jobs, demand workers. And that's one reason that we should just prepare workers for all kinds of skilled professions, not knowing for sure what the next good middle-class job will be.
Thank you. Senator Olquist.
Thank you. First of all, as a former educator, I'd like to say I believe we can educate most all of our children to become skilled workers. But I want to just share a few things that I gleaned from what you said, and to me how that's really the setting for what we will be talking about. First of all, having been born in 1944, I remember my family talking about the Marshall Plan, what was being done for GIs. I remember certainly the space program in the 1960s. I remember being 12 years old and seeing phones that had faces and people talking back and forth to each other and thinking, geez, math and science must really be a neat thing. That's one piece of what I remember. And then what I'm really hearing today is that I was fortunate to be born when I was into a low middle income family, because I would not have had that opportunity if I were born in 2004. So that's my first big point. The unemployment rate is certainly highest for low-income workers, as you mentioned. The gap between high and low-income workers is more dramatic in California, so this really sets the picture for what is happening here. Then I look at what we'll be talking about when it comes to CalWORKs, in that the benefit cuts, 74% will be to CalWORKs recipients, will be to women and children, and for the children, almost 50% of them are age 6 or younger. So that is the picture. So we had the Marshall Plan, then we had the space program, and I leave my colleagues with a question, and that is, it's 2012, so what are we doing today to really help our children? Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Wright, and then we're going to move on to Ms. Ross's. Now, the downstairs was very quiet, and we saw a lot of applause with hand motion. If we could pass that message up to the gallery as well. Thank you. Senator
going
Wright.
Going back a little to where Senator Hancock was, I was reading a book many years ago by Jeremy Rifkin that was called The End of Work, and he chronicled exactly where we are. If you take electricity, in 1940, it took about 400 to 500 hours of labor to produce a megawatt of electricity. Today, it's 75. If I go into cars, there's been, in the last 40 years, a 70% reduction in the number of hours it takes to make a car. If I go into telephones, telephones have seen an 85% reduction in the number. I mean, I can remember when, if I called overseas, I had to get the overseas operator, and then the overseas operator contacted an operator in the country that I was calling, and then that operator would call an operator at the local place where I was trying to reach someone. Last year, I called someone on a cell phone from the jungle in Rwanda, Africa, and I called this building, and there was no human being that intervened in that call. And the call was just as clear as if I was across the street. In Rifkin's work, what he described was that as you reduce the need for work, at some point we're going to have to change how we value the work. California built its economy on manufacturing at a time when manufacturing was very labor intensive. It's no longer particularly labor intensive. So we're going to have to decide, for example, is a 40 million population California a reality? I mean, we've even seen a 40% reduction in what you need for farming and agriculture between mechanizations and technologies. So we're going to have to make some hard choices because the technology is doing what it does, as Rifkin pointed out 20 years ago. So I think, for example, on the upper end, we're paying people for things that don't add value. So, I mean, if I'm a hedge fund operator, I didn't add any value to the economy, but I was paid disproportionately more than someone who, say, was a gardener or a childcare worker. So what we have, in part, is a displaced set of values that contributes to what we have in terms of how we value what people do. We may have to look at a world where we started out where a workday used to be 12 hours, then it was 10, now it's 8. You know what? Maybe it needs to be 6. Because as you shift and you provide more leisure time, then that means that other activities spring up. Disneyland grew, as did amusement parks, because people had more leisure time. I'm just saying, at its core, you're not going to create a demand in power or car manufacturing or farming or the others because that's no longer necessary. So you're either going to pay more and reduce the number of people that you need and recognize that, take some away from the upper end and redistribute some of that income, or you're just going to have the continued inequality that you've described. I mean, it's a great book, Rifkin's call, and it's literally called, the title is The End of Work. And he's absolutely right in terms of what I think we have to do. But you're not going to go back to a 1940s economy where it took, you know, 100 guys to produce a megawatt of electricity. That day's gone.
Thank you, Senator. Gene Ross, welcome. There you go.
Got it. Thank you. I'd like to thank the chair and members of the committee for taking the time to place the governor's proposals in a broader social and economic context. And I will address most of my remarks to what's happened to single-parent families and women during the Great Recession. A lot of this draws from a report that we released several weeks ago, Falling Behind, which looked at both what's happened to women in the the labor market as well as the impact of budget cuts. And in the slides that I believe are in your packet, I also included some from a report that we released last fall, which looked at issues related to income inequality. And I think they're particularly interesting because we used Franchise Tax Board data, which take into account investment income, capital gains in particular, which have become a much larger part of the compensation of very high-income individuals. Sarah used census data, which doesn't include capital gains in related income. So I think everything that she talked about actually understates the problem when you look at all types of income that come into households in California. And what we found is that between 1987 and 2009, which was the best time series we had using FTB data, that the incomes of the bottom 80% of California personal income taxpayers, which is their unit of analysis, actually fell behind relative to inflation, which I think is a very stunning figure, that we're not talking the bottom, the middle. We're talking seriously into sort of upper middle income Californians as well that have seen their standard of living decline.
Yes.
I'd like to talk now about what's happened to women, particularly women who are single parent heads of households. Going back from just prior to the implementation of welfare reform in the 1990s through the dot-com boom, the recession in the early part of the last decade, and more recently. And what's really stunning about the so-called Great Recession is it's the first in recent history in which women experienced substantial job loss. During the early 1990s, in California nation as a whole, during the early part of the last decade, women's employment held up fairly well. That was because of the industries that were most affected during those downturns. And actually, going into the Great Recession in California, and I should also say, I think underscoring Senator Emerson's comments and some others, that everything that we report is true for the nation as a whole, as well as California. So this isn't something different or something that was done wrong in California. They're broader national trends. Going into the Great Recession, we had what a lot of economists called a man-cession. And that was because the housing industry construction led the downturn. Men lost jobs early on. What's happened more recently, and particularly since we formally turned the corner, is that women's employment has actually continued to fall while male employment has stabilized. So now we have what the same pundits are calling a he-covery. So men are doing, we went man-session to he-covery is sort of the pundits' term for what's going on in the labor market. And again, this is absolutely unprecedented. And in the last 3 years, the share of single mothers with jobs has fallen by 10 percentage points, which erased all of the gains that we saw after welfare reform in the last decade, where you saw a lot of women move into the workforce, get jobs, keep jobs, little bit of a dip during the dot-com collapse, a tremendous drop more recently. When you look more deeply at the data, what begins to explain why women are not doing quite so well now is the fact that we're seeing public sector job loss, nonprofit sector job loss, and then jobs that are largely supported by public dollars. And that's where women are disproportionately employed. It's teachers, it's childcare workers, it's all of the things that women do in the economy that are not coming back as strongly as private sector employment. And that's why women are falling behind as the economy slowly begins to stabilize. What we've seen because of those trends and because of the tremendous job loss among single women with children is that the poverty rate for single-parent families, both headed by women and men, has increased substantially. In fact, the poverty rate for single father-headed families has increased more, although it's at a much lower rate. And that's because if you only have one wage earner in a family, if they lose their job, it's more likely to plunge a family into poverty. I'd like to switch gears a little bit and talk about why should we care about these trends and what's particularly troubling. And I think most fundamentally, it's because mobility up the income ladder is much less than is commonly believed. And I think there's sort of one of the great myths of American society is you can get out there, work hard, and move up the economic ladder. The data doesn't support that supposition. It's becoming less true all of the time. And we know that when children are raised in poverty, children are raised in low-income households, that they're more likely to stay at the bottom end of the income distribution. And when we talk about the CalWORKs program, we know that almost 8 out of the 10 people that we're talking about are children. This really is a program that provides income support to children, helps their parents find and keep jobs. And when children grow up in two-thirds of the adults who grew up in the bottom fifth of the income distribution ended up in the bottom 40% of the income distribution. So they might move a little bit up the income ladder. The odds of moving very far are extremely slim. And you can see this is sort of, you know, contrary to the Horatio Alger story of what happens if you work hard and try to get ahead. Very, very few adults who started out in low-income households ever move to the high end of the income distribution later on in life. That's largely true because of education. We know that children who grow up in low-income households are much less likely to go on, graduate from high school, go on to college. I think Sarah talked about the importance of education. And so much of the job gain that we, or so much of the gains in earnings that we've seen in recent decades has gone to those individuals with at least a bachelor's degree or higher. And increasingly, it's higher than a bachelor's degree or more. And that's, I think, important as you consider what counts as a work activity under the CalWORKs program, because if we're talking about trying to move families not only off of welfare into work but out of poverty, education really is the ticket to moving ahead. Important for the families. It's also important because that models good behavior for kids. They see mom, sometimes dad, go on to college, and that increases the likelihood that a child will go on to college later on in life. To close, one of the things, and again, I think Sarah talked about some of the trends that we've seen in recent years in the economy as a whole. When we look at how our public policies reflect those changes, what we see today, particularly at the federal level, also at the state level, is that public policies do less to mitigate the gap between high-income earners and low-income earners. Our public policies do less to move families out of poverty. They still help, but they don't help as much as they have in prior decades. And I think this is why if we keep on the current path, the prognosis for the future is not as good as we might hope that it might be. I think Senator Hancock Hancock's question about the allocation of work, which Senator Wright followed up upon, is an interesting one. If you look at countries that have lower levels of unemployment, lower levels of income inequality, a lot of them are countries that have shorter work weeks, shorter work years. And that certainly is one way that those economies have adapted to some of the changes that we're seeing in the broader economy. That's a thought-provoking and excellent question. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ross. And I didn't thank Ms. Bone for your presentation earlier. We're going to move on to Professor Duerbarek, and I'm sure hopefully have a little time for questioning. I was hoping we could complete the panel by around 11 o'clock. That gives us not much more than 8-10 minutes. But, Professor, we welcome you.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you, Senator Leno, and thank you, Senate Budget Committee members. I very much appreciate you taking time this morning to address these weighty issues and the very significant concerns that you'll be dealing with throughout the day. My name is Jill Duerbarek, and I'm on the faculty at the University of California at Berkeley, so I'm delighted to be here today. We've been talking about families so far this morning, but it's very easy to lose sight of the fact that children are nested inside of families. And it's very easy also for those children to become invisible. And so my hope is, with my brief comments, to make some of their issues somewhat more visible to all of us today and to remember that the considerations you'll be dealing with today center directly on the lives of children and the consequences for all of them in California. You know, before the Great Recession of 2008, child poverty rates in California and in the United States were much higher than adult poverty rates. Child poverty rates were also much higher in the United States than they were in any other industrialized country. What's concerning is that since the Great Recession, child poverty rates have been rising steadily. So in just from 2009 to 2010, in a single year, the number of children living in poverty in California rose by over 200,000 children, or 9%. Today, across the state of California, over 2 million children are living in poverty. Senator Hancock, if you were to think about the district you represent and the entire Bay Area, if we took all of the children in all 13 Bay Area counties and put them in one place, that's the number of children we're referring to in terms of 2 million children in California. The most recent figures show that California's poverty rate is about 23%. And according to the Brookings Institute, there is an expectation that by the end of this year, 2012, it will be 25%, or 1 in 4 children in the state of California living in poverty. I should mention also that the rates of extreme poverty also grew substantially during this time period. And when I refer to extreme poverty, I'm referring to children who are living at or below 50% of the poverty line, which is about $11,000 for a family of four. And I should also note that current CalWORKs grants in California keep the average family at or below extreme poverty at the current CalWORKs grant rate. What's also important to recognize is that poverty is not distributed evenly across our state. So if you're a Latino or an African American child in the state of California, your poverty rates are significantly higher, more like 1 in 3 children. And if you're a very young child, then your poverty rates are also disproportionately high. Across the state of California, we also see that the distribution is quite diverse. Many of your districts are represented on this graph, and you'll see that the northern counties, the Central Valley counties, the northern coastal counties experience significantly and disproportionately high rates of child poverty compared to some of our other counties in the state. You know, one of my great role models, Marion Wright Edelman, who was the founder and executive director of the Children's Defense Fund in Washington, D.C., compares our response, our governmental response to child poverty, similar to how we might think about an American family. I've modified her words slightly, but in essence, she says, how would we feel about a family that kept 3 of its 4 children well-fed, well-clothed, and well-educated, but let the fourth go hungry, let the fourth go without health care or good preparation for the future? And that's the question that we need to think about when we're looking at 1/4 of California's children living in poverty, or depending upon the county you live in, there may even be fewer tables at the chairs at the table. We've talked a lot about poverty today. We've used a lot of numbers to convey that it's a significant problem. It's rife throughout the state. But we really need to take a moment to think about what does this really mean in terms of the lives of children. Because if a child were born and raised in poverty, and it was a randomly distributed event, and it was really no different than living on the left side of the street or the right side of the street or having blonde hair or brunette hair, none of us would worry about it. We would just say that's not a problem. It just is a fact. But the problem is poverty has these very significant effects, effects that are pernicious, effects that are long-lasting, and we need to remember again that the effects of poverty disproportionately affect very young children under the age of 6, which is the largest proportion of children on the CalWORKs, in the CalWORKs program, and it also disproportionately affects children of color. So I'm just going to list a laundry list of concerns that evidence over the last 40 years of rigorous research suggests that there are very significant correlations between being raised in poverty and other life events. So for example, and most profoundly, children who are born into poverty are more likely to die in the first year of life. Children who are born into poverty are more likely to experience low birth weight, to have birth complications, to have poor nutrition, chronic health conditions, stunted growth, more illnesses, more injuries. These are consequential for the child, these are consequential for the family, and these are consequential for the health systems that we support with our public dollars. As children grow, they're more likely to live in communities where they experience environmental toxins. They're more likely to attend schools that are of poorer quality, which have long-lasting impacts for their education. In adolescence, they're much more likely to drop out of high school. They're much more likely to become teen parents. They're much more likely to engage in criminal activity. One of the components of living in poverty that we're trying to understand as researchers is that it seems to affect the actual architecture of the brain. So during the first 3 years of life, as children are growing and the synapses are forming, it appears that children who are raised in low-income families have a different architecture of the brain. What does that mean? That means it affects their learning. So if you look at the age of 3, children in low-income families have a vocabulary that's one-third as great as children from middle-income families. And importantly, although we are all very, very familiar with the black-white achievement gap in school, a new Stanford study suggests that the gap between rich children and poor children is now twice as great as the gap between African Americans and Caucasian children. So this is where we're really seeing the education gap most profound. When children grow into adults, as Jean suggested a moment ago earlier, they're not particularly likely to be well off financially. So low-income children are very likely to grow up to become low-income adults. And what does that mean? They're less likely to be employed. They're going to have lower earnings. They're going to have higher rates of adult poverty. They're going to have high rates of single parenthood. And again, poor health, which again, all of these tax our economy, tax all of our public dollars. So just in summary, let me remind you, child poverty is rising. It's rising rapidly. It does not appear to be abating. It is not leveled off yet. It has significant short-term and long-term effects. And importantly, it has implications not only for the children who are raised in poverty, but it has implications for all of us Californians that are quite profound. So thank you so much for your attention. I appreciate it.
Professor, we thank you very much as well. I think we've laid out a clear recognition of what the state of California is right now, not even broader across the country, how children are suffering disproportionately. And the question before us is, we bring up the administration to offer their proposal in the context of this coming year's budget, is what is the state's responsibility and what responsibility can we take on with our current resources? Colleagues, can we move forward, keep on track, or do we have a couple questions? Okay, Senator Lowenthal.
One quick question. I found that fascinating. And the issue that I have, I was struck with the range of poverty both through rural and urban areas. And I'm wondering, is there anything that we can learn between the differences or what you've learned between more rural child poverty and urban child poverty? Is there some, maybe not, but are there lessons? Because it's just striking to see in that presentation, it just struck me
The range is quite dramatic, isn't
right.
it? Some of the data that we have about the differences between rural and urban child poverty are the differences in the service systems designed to support those families.
Mm-hmm.
So as we know, in rural communities, the service system is generally less prevalent, more fragmented, much more difficult to access. So some of those issues, particularly in California, are especially difficult in our response to poverty, not necessarily in the essence of how it's formed.
Thank you.
Senator Evans.
Yeah, just to follow up on that, I think I just want to make a statement. As we go through this analysis of the governor's budget proposal, since I'm representing six rural counties, and the safety net is very fragile, and in many, many places it is breaking down completely to the point where people do not have services. I had a woman in my office yesterday in tears, saying she didn't know what she was going to do if we cut a certain program, because there will be no services in Lake County where she lives. So I just want us to look at how this is impacting people in rural communities as we take a look at the governor's proposals, because by and large it doesn't often get assessed. Thanks for bringing that up.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Hancock.
Yeah, I was struck with the same map and the fact that Yuba County would have a 30% child poverty rate. I mean, it's huge. And I think there was another county, Orange or someplace, with 19 or 15%. So does that have to do with local choices, state choices? Where does it come from?
Well, part of that just reflects the average income in each of those counties. And we know those counties have very different economic bases, of course. Lake County, for example, rural, more agricultural. Orange County is a center of a good deal of industry. You have Long Beach, you have just a very different service system, different manufacturing system, different economic base. And so I think those different economic bases, as we've been talking about, in terms of the changing distribution of work and how the work landscape is changing across California, you see that then played out in these different districts that rely upon a different economic base for families' well-being.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Senator. I'm going to grab last question here. Ms. Ross, on page 8 of your report, you have a bar graph. The incomes of the wealthy increased significantly over the past 2 decades, while those of all other Californians declined. It's a rather striking bar graph with a line just like that, from the bottom fifth to the top 1%. The question is, that's over the past 2 decades.
Yeah.
Has it always been as such? And or is this a recent phenomenon?
No, I think, as Ms. Bone said, this is very much a recent phenomenon, and the gap has widened significantly. And again, it's interesting if you compare the data that I presented versus hers. Ours ended in 2009, which was actually a not very good year at the top end of the income distribution. If you go back to 2008, you would see that the bottom 80% fell behind inflation. The top 1% incomes had more than doubled. So, and again, it's related to investment income earnings in 2009, which were fairly slow. No, absolutely. And I think if you look now, and again, depending on what your endpoint year, we are at a level of inequality nationally wider than we've seen since any time since the late 1920s, immediately prior to the Great Depression. And if you look, Professor Emmanuel Saez from Berkeley has done a lot of very interesting work looking at inequality nationally. And he argues that when we come out of this downturn, again, because of the disparities in incomes related to education, because of some of the disparities in between areas with very strong economic bases versus weaker bases, that he believes that we will see inequality spike again coming out of the Great Recession, as we see that pulling apart from the top to the bottom, unless public policies change significantly.
Thank you. And would you have the data to be able to put together a bar graph going back earlier 20 years? So if this was from 90 to the present, would we have a 70 to a 90 graph?
I need to go back and check. I believe that there's some problems in terms of getting a time series that goes back prior to that year, but I certainly will check, and I will get back to you and your staff.
Great. Well, again, we thank you all very much for bringing all this information to us, and it sets the stage for what we're going to do today. And, colleagues, we're going to establish our quorum, so if you could call the roll, please.
Leno.
Here.
Emerson.
Here.
Ahlquist. Anderson. DeSalne.
Here.
Evans.
Here.
Fuller.
Here.
Gaines. Hancock.
Here.
LaMalfa. Liu.
Here.
Lowenthal.
Here.
Negrete McLeod.
Here.
Simidian.
Yeah, I just heard it.
Wolk.
Here.
Wright.
Here.
All right, we have our quorum established. Thank you, colleagues. So we're going to ask Brian Euler from the LAO's office to join us. And before we ask the administration to present its CalWORKs proposals, Mr. Euler is going to give us a description of the current CalWORKs program. And if you could briefly summarize some of the reductions that we've made in recent years.
Thank you, Chairman Leno and members. I'll be presenting from a handout that hopefully you all have in front of you. The handout has two parts, and kind of as outlined by your agenda and as Senator Leno has just suggested, I'll be speaking mainly to the background and some recent history in the program. And then we'll be returning with some comments after the administration has presented their proposal.
Great.
Moving into the handout on page two, we would begin with a basic background of the CalWORKs program. The CalWORKs program was created to provide cash grants and welfare to work services to families whose income and resources are inadequate to meet their family's basic needs. The cash grant for a family varies by the size of the family and where the family resides. A family of three in a high-cost county under current law receives a monthly cash grant of $638. Once on CalWORKs, a recipient may remain eligible despite having earned income because of what's known as the earned income disregard, which does not count the first 112 and the remaining 50% of income when calculating a family's cash grant. All able-bodied adult recipients are required to participate in certain categories of work activities as a condition of receiving cash assistance. And adults that fail to meet these work requirements can be subject to sanctions which reduce the family's cash grant by the amount attributable to the adult. Adults can receive welfare to work services which can assist them in meeting their work requirements, and this can consist of assessments by county case managers, development of a welfare to work plan, subsidized child care, and reimbursement for ancillary expenses such as travel costs. And finally, adults are limited to a cumulative 4 years or 48 months in aid. Children in families with adults that have reached a time limit will continue to be aided in what's informally known as the safety net. And children in families who have an adult who is not work eligible and therefore does not receive a grant are informally referred to as child-only cases. CalWORKs is funded by a combination of federal, state, and local dollars, and in roughly that order of magnitude. Each year, California receives a $3.7 billion federal temporary assistance for needy families, or TANF, block grant. The TANF funds can be spent on any purposes that can be reasonably calculated to meet the four purposes of the TANF program, although California spends the majority of these funds on CalWORKs. In order to receive the full cash grant, California must meet maintenance of effort and work participation requirements. To meet its maintenance of effort requirement, the state is required to spend $2.9 billion annually in activities specified by the TANF program. While this is primarily met through expenditures in CalWORKs, other expenditures such as those in subsidized child care also count towards the state's maintenance of effort requirement. To meet its federal work participation requirement, the state must ensure that 50% of able-bodied CalWORKs recipients are participating in some category of work activities. Although this requirement can be reduced by what is known as a caseload reduction credit, which reduces the requirement based on recent reductions in the caseload. And the state can be subject to federal penalties for failing to meet this work requirement. And as we discuss on page 5 in the handout, in fact, the state has failed to meet this federal work requirement since 2007, a year in which the state's caseload reduction credit was significantly reduced due to changes in federal law. The state's projected to continue to fail to meet its federal work participation requirement in future years, the consequences of which would be possible future federal penalties. The state has been assessed penalties for failure to meet its work participation requirement in 2008 and 2009. Those penalties were $47 million and $113 million, respectively.
Is there any hope that the federal government will credit us in any future date for partial participation in work?
So there is some discussion of that, although, you know, I'm not prepared to opine on whether or not, you know,
projection.
I'm not prepared to provide a projection one way or another.
Are other states suffering as we are, given that if someone doesn't meet the 30 hours by 2 or 3 hours, we get no credit for that at all?
Yeah.
Other states are in similar situations.
There are other states in similar circumstances in that they're not meeting their federal requirements as well. And it should be noted that we have appealed the federal penalties in 2008 and 9, and that they haven't actually been, there hasn't been any actual reduction in our TANF block grant effectuated from those
Would it take penalties. An act of Congress to change that, or can that be done administratively?
I believe it's administratively.
Very good. Senator Negrete-McLeod.
Isn't it unrealistic to expect the federal government for us to meet this when there were no jobs, whether they were on TANF or whether they were people out in the public that were looking for jobs, because there were no jobs to put these people in?
I can't speak to the thought process at the federal level of developing the requirement that we have to meet. I can speak to, the graphic that we have on page 5 shows are the work participation rate in the program has historically been about in the mid-20s, which might suggest that a 50% target is a pretty high one for the program to meet.
Thank you. Sorry for the interruption.
So then the final piece of background is a summary of the recent reductions in the last 3 years in the CalWORKs program. On page 6, we provide that summary. The reductions have resulted in $780 million in ongoing reductions in expenditures in the CalWORKs program. The major ongoing reductions in the program are a cumulative 12% cash grant reduction for families, a reduction of the adult time limit from 60 months to 48 months, and a reduction in the earned income disregard. In addition, several temporary reductions were made in the last 3 years, the most significant of which was in each of the last 3 years, we significantly reduced funding for employment services and childcare, as well as intensive case management for pregnant and parenting teens and substance abuse and mental health treatment. Although under current law, the funding for those services would be restored. As a result of these ongoing reductions, funding for the CalWORKs program has remained relatively flat over the last few years, despite rising caseloads from the recent recession.
Thank you, Mr. Euler. There was one graph in Ms. Ross's report which indicated that as a percentage of our state budget spending in around the mid-90s, when we had as many as 900,000 families in our welfare program, that it was about 6.87% of spending, and now we're at about 3%, even with the increase of the recent recession, now that we're back up to about 587,000, having been at a low of about 500,000, that's all pretty accurate?
Yes, yeah.
All right. Senator Emerson has a question for you, and then we're going to move on to Mr. Lightborn and Mr. Bland.
Thank you. I have a couple of questions I'd like to ask. First, Where does California rank among the 10 largest states with regard to CalWORKs cash grants?
You may know that in our recent report that we released last week in our analysis of the proposal, we did do an analysis similar to this, where we looked at cash grants as a percent of state median income. And based on that metric, California is the second highest among the 10 largest states.
And secondly, can you talk a little bit about the programs that are available to low-income families in addition to the CalWORKs grants, both at the state and maybe some at the local level?
So the two most significant programs that would be available to a family with no earned income would be CalFresh benefits and Medi-Cal. Almost all CalWORKs recipients are also eligible for those two programs. Families that are participating in work activities or unsubsidized employment would also be eligible to receive unsubsidized child care. And in addition, those with earned income would be able to receive various tax incentives, such as the earned income tax credit at the federal level.
And housing?
Housing is available, although demand probably far outweighs supply for public housing.
And can you give me some idea of what those extra benefits could mean to a family in terms of dollars outside of the grant?
Yes. So just as an example, a family of three in a high-cost county, as I said, the cash grant is $638 for that family monthly. CalFresh benefits on average would be about $478 in addition to that. And I believe the Department of Social Services assigned a cash value to the monthly Medi-Cal benefit as well, which is around $468 a month.
And the housing and all those others would be in addition.
Right. And to the extent that the family was able to secure housing, it's my understanding that it's not available for all of the CalWORKs recipients.
Okay. Thank you.
In ranking California relative to grant levels, if we factor in the cost of housing, I would imagine that changes then?
Yes. I mean, our adjustment of normalizing by state median income is somewhat of an attempt to adjust for cost of living across states, although we admit it's imperfect and, you know, further work would be needed to kind of address those specific differences, such as the cost of housing across states.
I've seen some figures where we're closer to a middle position among states when we factor in housing costs. And also interesting to note that California ranks 50th out of states of eligible residents participating in food stamp program just because of some of the hurdles we put in place. All right, so thank you for the background information. And we'll ask Will Lightborn and Todd Bland to join us from the administration. Of course, Senator Emerson.
To the LAO, I have a further question. You know, the grants that we provide to families under the child-only program where parents are unable to work, does that skew our work issues with the federal government?
Lessening
our participation rates?
So families that the majority of the child-only caseload are families that are headed by an adult who is not considered work eligible. The majority of those are undocumented immigrants and parents who are receiving SSI. And so those families are not included in our calculation of our federal requirements.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Mr. Euler. I know you're going to be coming back to give us your analysis of that which the administration is now to propose to us. Welcome, Mr. Lightborn, Mr. Bland.
Good morning, Chair Leno and committee members. Will Lightbourne, Director of the Department of Social Services. I'm joined by Todd Bland, our Deputy Director for Welfare to Work Services, and of course, Department of Finance staff are present as well.
Mr. Kapoor, Mr. Lee.
I would just note that the prior panel raised some extraordinarily profound questions, both about our economy and our vision of work and our vision of civic participation that your committee engaged in. The CalWORKs program in and of itself perhaps can't address all of those questions, but obviously we are within that context. And it's within that context that I want to thank committee staff and member staff for helping us schedule and be here for this, what is frankly a presentation of, in some ways, a difficult proposal. It's difficult in several ways. First, it is complex as a proposal, which I think is understandable because it is trying to address sort of a reformulation and refashioning of the whole program, not just a across-the-board grant cut or services funding cut. That said, it's a complex proposal to explain, and it will be complex in its implementation. When implemented, in some respects, it may actually be a simpler program than what we operate now. But definitely between here and there, both in our presentation and then the work counties will have to do it, there is a great deal of complexity.
So you're forewarning us you're going to confuse us.
Yes. And the I would sort of add to that the difficulty of the fact that there are a number of sort of pieces of the proposal that are still sort of emerging as we engage stakeholders, and details are identified and possible anomalies are spotted that were not intentional, and so we will be, you know, undoubtedly sort of bringing refinements forward as we move forward. It also does not yet assume any behavioral changes on the part of program participants. We will bring those assumptions when we bring the May revision forward, but at this point it doesn't make those assumptions, and so it simply shows impacts as though nothing changed other than program structure. And finally, it's a difficult proposal in that we're operating in a budget resource environment that is very constrained and that defies in some respects preferable alternatives, although we keep, you know, there's certainly an openness to engage all alternatives as we move this forward. To sort of start with discussing sort of the core changes that we're proposing for the CalWORKs program itself, I would just want to observe that I was one of those who was there at the beginning of the CalWORKs program, and at its outset, it was a robust, outstanding program that I think achieved in California probably the best results, as good as any state and better than most. And the fact that over time, the sort of resources available to the state and the circumstances have changed, force decisions and choices, and have been over a period of time. Over the last several years, collectively, we have made what started out being thought of as temporary adjustments to the program, either in terms of funding for services and concomitant exemptions to participants, along with the grant cuts the LAO described, that at the time were thought of as being temporary, but as the ability to undo them eludes us, leaves us with an under-resourced program on the one hand, a large number of exempt people on the other hand, and as just mentioned, the fact that we have failed work participation requirements for several years and without program adjustment aren't likely to correct that, and therefore face a penalty environment. I don't want to make it sound like the penalty is here now. We've appealed those penalties that are associated with the failed years, and we would expect to engage in corrective action with the federal government, even if our appeals aren't granted on the face. But they still help set that difficult environment. As we refocus the program, the goals in the governor's budget proposal are to first build on the strengths and successes. We know that The highest number of exits of people with earnings from the program occur in the first 2 years. And hence what we want to do is focus the resources of the program on the earliest possible engagement with participants so that we don't sort of find ourselves in the situation where, as sort of the data from EDD and other unemployment sources tell us, the longer someone is unemployed, the more likely they are to stay unemployed longer, and the cycle presses itself forward. We want to increase the incentive to participate in work and thus build financial bonuses, in a sense, to those participants who are working, meeting work participation requirements, and have those bonuses continue to their children even after the adult has reached the full 48-month limit under current program structure. As I said, we want to better position the state to meet our WPR requirements, making the best use that we have of limited resources. And what we also want to do is address the fact that we do have a sizable caseload of children, California's poorest children, who are served in this program because their parents either are unable to work or have been unable to access work. And we want to make sure that we preserve a child well-being component that assures that we continue the state's support to those children, both income support as well as social support. The redesigned, refocused program that would have two CalWORKs work-related tracks. First would be what we're referring to as CalWORKs Basic, which is essentially indistinguishable from the current program. For the first 24 months of participation, participants would have full access to services in the grant so long as they're successfully meeting their welfare-to-work plan. It's not denominated by a particular number of hours and a particular component. It's the welfare-to-work plan developed in conjunction with their county. Additionally, the proposal is for a CalWORKs Plus program, which can be accessed at any point in the 48-month period. For the adult who is meeting the work participation requirement, they would then, in addition to continuing the grant, would also receive an increased income disregard. As the LAO just described, it's currently 112, the first 112 and 50%. This would increase that to $200 and 50%. And that increased income disregard would continue for so long as the child in that household was eligible for the program, the child maintenance program, and as long as the parent was meeting WPR. The increased income disregard would continue. Separate from that, the administration is proposing to have a child maintenance program to recognize the fact that we have a significant number of children being aided and need aid in the future whose parents are unable to work or haven't been able to access the labor market. And the proposal in the governor's budget is to continue this, calling it a child maintenance program, to reduce the reporting requirements from what is currently quarterly, would become semi-annual under changes that were adopted last year by the legislature. We would reduce that further to an annual reporting requirement, but an additional eligibility requirement of a well child examination annually, so that we have the confidence that the child's physical needs are being met in addition to the income support. This, of course, component in the proposal includes the significant grant cut to the child maintenance caseload, and we realize that's a subject of great deal of concern and discussion. The time frame for how this would occur under the proposal is that 6 months after enactment, the CalWORKs Basic program would come into existence, and then a year after enactment, the CalWORKs Plus program would come into existence. Everyone would have, therefore, a minimum of a year before the effects of the 24-month limit affected them, although depending on noticing and notification processes, if people weren't it could be as short as 6 months in effect, as the proposal is actually structured. But the assumption we would make is that there would be widespread awareness of the fact that the change is occurring, and therefore the effectiveness is a year. The child maintenance program transitions would then begin in the fall, in October 2012, and those families that had not made the transition to the CalWORKs Plus program but had exhausted the 24-month or 6-month window would also transition to the child maintenance program in April 2013. To mention the other components of the proposal, other than the child care discussion, which is this afternoon, the governor's budget proposal also includes making permanent what was the temporary elimination of the case management component of the CalLEARN program, but it preserves funding for the bonuses for parenting teens who are receiving the CalWORKs benefit. They are not counted towards their 24-month service clock while they're in school, and the counties are free to serve them through their regular welfare to work services. The two additional components that are addressed in the proposal to help meet the work participation requirement for the state are what we refer to as the WINS and WINS Plus program. WINS was actually adopted by the legislature a couple of years ago. Its implementation was delayed. As adopted, what it would do is add a $10 food, state-funded food benefit for those food stamp recipients who are not getting cash assistance but are meeting work participation. The administration's proposal increases the benefit to $50. I'm sorry, it was originally 40. It's increased to 50 in the administration's proposal. And then in addition to the WINS program, which would address CalFresh recipients, WINS Plus would be the similar benefit applied to people receiving subsidized child care whose incomes were under 200% of poverty, which is the TANF limit, and who were meeting work participation requirements. By doing so, we can count both populations towards the state's numerator in the calculation of work participation. By themselves, that does not achieve the state requirements for work participation. The intention is that the broader refocusing will, over time, let us start to increase the other components of work participation and eventually meet the requirements. Finally, the other change within the proposal that I should mention is historically there have been several categories of recipient who were exempted from grant reductions over the past decade. Approximately 104,000 households are therefore receiving grants at levels higher than what we think of as the normal CalWORKs grant. The governor's proposal reduces those grants to the regular CalWORKs grant level. That would be in the CalWORKs basic program. To conclude, I'd like to thank you for hearing the proposal. Close by saying that while I realize that there are many challenging aspects to it and there's a lot of discussion that we'll need to be moving forward with legislature, stakeholders, county partners as we move forward, at the same time, I think we're in an environment where we have to, at the end of the day, come to a whole cloth conclusion to how we repurpose the program and refocus it, and that the environment in which we are both between fiscal limitations and work participation requirement shortfalls, that we're not in a position to further defer how we deal with the program. So I thank you for your attention. Happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Lightbourne. Mr. Bland? used to seeing you over on this end of the table.
Right.
I hope your transition to the inside has been smooth.
It has. Thank you, Senator.
I said inside, not dark side.
It's been. I have that chair for many years. It's a pleasure to be joining Mr. Lightmore and the department for the last 3 months.
Anything to add?
Today. Pardon?
Anything to add at this time?
We're looking forward to your questions, sir.
Okay, very good. Colleagues, I'm going to suggest that we will be better informed in our questions after we hear from Mr. Euler's LAO analysis of the proposal, and then we'll ask our questions.
I'm going to pick back up on page 7 of our handout. As the administration has described, they're putting forth a significant and complex change to the CalWORKs program. I won't repeat any of the description that Director Lightmore has provided, but I will direct you to a graphic that we have on the bottom of page 7, which is a flow chart that shows how a CalWORKs family would be, how it would be determined that the family would go into each of the three new programs.
As flow charts go, it's pretty good.
Thank you. to make it easier for the legislature to evaluate the governor's proposal, we suggest that you consider it as three major policy changes to the CalWORKs program, which are reducing cash grants for majority recipients, shortening the adult time limit, and modifying work requirements, accompanied by an administrative redesign of the program that would divide the current population into three new programs. We feel that these two components of the proposal do not need to be linked. That is, you could evaluate the and even adopt and achieve the associated savings of the three major policy changes without also adopting the administrative redesign. And for that reason, we would recommend that you reject the administrative redesign and consider the policy changes in the context of the current program.
You have a note here on page 8 that you believe that the proposed changes to the administrative structure do not yield any apparent programmatic benefits in and of themselves, I would ask, or additional savings?
Yes.
That's accurate.
Yes.
There's
no additional savings. Yes. To be clear, what we're referring to with the administrative restructure is essentially just the creating of the three new sub-programs and moving of the caseload around. We're not speaking to any of the specific policy changes, the changes in grant levels, or the changes in earned income disgrant, all of those things which could be implemented within the current structure of the program.
Very good.
So I'll continue now by discussing each of the three major policy changes that that I described before. The first is significant reduction in cash grants for the current child-only safety net and chronically sanctioned population of CalWORKs. This reduction would reduce the combined cash grant and CalFresh benefits for these families to about 56% of federal poverty level as compared to 65% now. As the proposal would be targeted at a specific portion of the caseload, this would increase the difference in cash assistance between families that are working and those that aren't. And we concur with the administration's assertion that this could create a increased incentive for families to pursue work, although we would draw a distinction between an increase in incentive and the realized changes in the caseload in terms of work participation. We do feel that there would be a segment of the population that could see increased work participation and better circumstances from increased work incentives, but equally likely there's a segment of the population that may have additional barriers to employment that would not be able to respond with increased work and as a result would face decreased economic circumstances.
That's not an insignificant although that you've offered us.
No.
Because in real life, it just may not be an incentive at all.
No, and I did not intend to downplay the trade-off. It is a significant trade-off. And as we've noted in our handout and in our report, the target population of the governor's cash grant reduction has been documented to display significantly more barriers to employment than the average CalWORKs family.
You correct me, but I think I've seen some unemployment rate figures for that target population to be over 20%.
I don't really have that off the top of my head, but I won't confirm or deny, actually.
Mr. Bland?
Confirm or deny
I see Jean Ross shaking her head, so that's good enough for me. So we know this is a really challenged population.
Yes. Yeah. With that in mind, we suggest two options the legislature might wish to consider in the area of reduced maximum aid payment levels instead of the governor's proposal. The first would be an across-the-board reduction in cash grants that wouldn't target the reductions at any portion of the population, and more specifically, even one that may face more barriers to employment. Secondly, we may suggest that the cash grant reductions could be phased in, maybe over a six-month period to mitigate the immediate impact of a cash grant reduction.
Though there'd be some loss of savings, you peg it about $70 million.
There would, of course, be, yes, a loss of savings. We note that if you instituted the governor's proposal for full year saving, the governor's proposal reduced cash grants by 27% to the target population. Full year savings, by our estimates, would be about $610
million. Right.
A phased-in approach, say over 6 months, would produce savings of about $390 million by our estimates.
390, so that's a difference of 220. I thought the difference was closer to $70 million. Am I confused on something? $70 million, yes.
The difference there is that there's three estimates we would be working off of. Our full-year savings, the 610, somewhat consistent with our recommended approach that you consider this within the context of the current proposal, is also to not consider the governor's proposed timeline, to not start any of the changes until October, and then the full implementation in April of 2013. So when we say the $70 million less than the governor's proposed timeline is his timeline under his restructure that we're suggesting that you do not consider when looking at these changes. The second major policy change is shortening of the adult time limit to 24 months for most adults, except for those that are meeting federal work requirements through unsubsidized employment. I would note that the other major change that goes along with this is that months in exemption, both prior and going forward, would count against an adult's time on aid. An estimated 131,000 adults would lose aid as a result of the implementation of this proposal. As with the governor's proposed cash grant reduction, we do find that the shortened time limit could increase incentives for recipients to pursue work, but the same caveat applies as did with the cash grants, that this could have different effects on different portions of the population, and that there are significant trade-offs in the gains in employment that may be realized among some families.
Give any further thoughts on this retroactivity? So we, the state, exempted certain participants for reasons, let's say they had very young children, we wanted them to stay home with their very young children, so they were exempted. And then also, if they were caring for a disabled or ailing older parent, now we're saying that time which we gave them off would be counted against their 24 months.
That's correct. And in fact, we are recommending that the legislature, if it does pursue any sort of time limit reduction, would not apply that retroactively to months in exemption, essentially because the exemption policy somewhat implicitly had an understanding that the families would stay home, and as you mentioned, one example is stay home and care for their young children, with the understanding that they could return and receive a full duration of welfare to work services. And by counting the prior months, we would be violating that somewhat implicit agreement in the current exemption policy.
Significant change of rules mid-game.
Yes.
Okay. And you are recommending we not take that?
Yes. One option that we suggest to the governor's proposal would be to align the adult time limit with the average time on aid among CalWORKs families, which is roughly around 3 years or 36 months. And again, we wouldn't recommend that be applied retroactively to months in exemption.
and you're saving, and your peg savings of $140 million then compares to the $380, or that's...
That's correct.
That's correct.
So the 380 includes, there's two factors that are making that larger than our option. The first is that it's, of course, 24 instead of 36. The second is that it's looking at those months retroactively, so the exempt months retroactively.
All right. Thank you.
The third major change in the governor's proposal is to align the current CalWORKs work requirements with the federal TANF work requirements. The former, which is currently broader than the federal requirements, more specifically, higher education activities and timelines for mental health and substance abuse treatment are currently more permissive under state law than under the federal requirements. Although aligning to the federal requirements would also reduce the hours of participation for all single parents, and significantly for single parents with young children, the hours requirement would go from 32 hours a week to 20 hours a week. The fiscal impact of this change is somewhat difficult to determine. The administration hasn't attached any savings or costs to this particular portion of the proposal, and we find it hard to attach a particular number to it as well, mainly because of uncertain behavioral responses to the change in the work requirements. However, we do find that aligning to the federal requirements would likely increase the state's ability to meet, it would increase the state's WPR work participation rate, and that could reduce the risk of future federal penalties. For that reason, we find that in general, the idea of better aligning the state's work requirements to the federal requirements merits some consideration, but we do have one area of significant concern, which is aligning to the federal requirements as they pertain to mental health and substance abuse treatment. We find that the federal restrictions on those activities are impractical they could disrupt sufficient treatment of mental health and substance abuse issues among CalWORKs recipients. And for that reason, if the legislature were to consider better aligning the state requirements with federal requirements, we would recommend not doing so in that area.
You refer to them as not only impractical, but detrimental.
Yeah, yes.
And again, there's no scored cost savings.
No. So while the governor has proposed three major areas of achieving reductions in the CalWORKs budget, those aren't the only options that the legislature has for achieving savings in the program. And we've outlined in our analysis and in this handout on page 13 four additional options the legislature may wish to consider. We begin the discussion of any of the options with the recognition that because of recent reductions that we discussed earlier and the vulnerable population that CalWORKs serves, there aren't any reductions that can be made that won't involve significant trade-offs and won't have a negative impact on recipients. Although we feel that some of them may involve, the impact may be less than some of those put forward by the governor. For instance, the legislature could consider continuing the current year single allocation reduction for county funding for employment services and child care. While this involves a trade-off of not, effectively this wouldn't reduce the current service level in the program as this has been in place for the past 3 years, although the trade-off would be that there would be likely decreases in work participation among CalWORKs recipients.
When you say that the option of continuing the current year single allocation reduction would not result in new service level reduction, clearly it would just be keeping the status quo.
Yes.
But then you go on to say that it would likely have a negative effect on CalWORKs work participation. Do you know how significant that negative effect has been in recent years?
So since the implementation of the single allocation reductions, and the associated expansion in work exemptions, the one that you mentioned earlier, expanding the exemption for care of young children. Work participation among able-bodied adults in the program has gone down by about 11. The percentage of able-bodied adults that are participating in work activities has gone down by 11%. So
we could expect to see that continue.
Yeah. A second option would be to reduce and restructure the earned income disregard. The restructure portion would be recognizing that reducing further the earned income disregard could be detrimental to the work incentive influence of the earned income disregard. So we propose to move the incentive portion of the disregard to be focused more on the lowest level of earnings, essentially the entry point into the labor force, and decrease the marginal effect on relatively higher levels of earnings. The final two options that we include are to increase the severity of sanctions for noncompliance with work requirements, and reducing cash assistance after longer periods of aid. And a general comment about trade-offs on this one would apply that's similar to the ones that we made with the reduction in the targeted reduction in cash grants and the reduction in the time limit the governor has proposed, in that we find that these proposals would have kind of disparate effects on portions of the CalWORKs population. Those that were able to respond by finding work would be less impacted, but of course a significant portion of the population, it would be equally likely, would be moved further into poverty. On the final page of our handout, we have some illustrative budget packages the legislature could consider, building from the options presented by the governor and those that we've outlined. And this is really to show you the types of reductions that would need to be made to achieve various savings targets. And we do recognize that in light of the recent reductions in the program, the legislature may not want to achieve the same level of savings in this program as the governor has proposed. And for that reason, we've outlined packages that achieve less than the governor has set forth. In closing, in evaluating the reductions to CalWORKs, the legislature will have to weigh the impact of reductions on recipients against the need for broader budgetary savings. And in addition, we suggest that the legislature gives care to balancing the increase in the CalWORKs work participation with the recognition of the barriers to employment that I've mentioned that many families in the program.
The same caveat. Thank you. The three different suggested savings of 500, 750, and 1 billion on page 14 is really helpful for us, because these are the trade-offs, these are the mix and matchings that we're going to have to be considering, and our options are few. So I wanted to thank you for that. And then just to underscore that the LAO had stated, I think just earlier this week when you came out with your revenue projections, that you thought it wisest for us not to take action currently, though the governor is suggesting that we do so, because we will know more clearly exactly where we are after the April revenue has been received?
Yes, that's correct.
All right. Thank you for the analysis. We'll now return to Mr. Lightport and Mr. Bland. And where to begin? With regard to the allowance for recipient families to receive aid only if they're participating in non-subsidized work.
Right.
And again, I want to say as respectfully as possible, I think that I'll speak for myself, not for my colleagues, that I have no doubt that the governor is as concerned as I am and as we are for the well-being of those who are who have been hit the most, and as we've looked at in the first panel today, and that our options are really very few without any without additional revenue or even with some revenue. But at the same time, given the high unemployment rate and the few options for non-subsidized work, do you presume that, in fact, if folks just get themselves trained and prepared for work, that there'll be work for them?
Let me respond in this fashion, Senator. First, the expectation of the program is that once barrier removal services and labor market services have been provided, there is a there has logically got to be a point after which the further provision of services aren't likely to increase the engagement. So there's a, and whether that's a 24-month, 48, we could put the numbers out. So the expectation is that we're trying to find the right time frame and the right combination of, is it purely unsubsidized work or is it unsubsidized work plus other activities that can help us both in get people engaged with the labor market and also help us meet the state's obligations under the TANF program in terms of WPR. I certainly don't want to make it sound as though the proposal is absolutely inflexible in what that right combination is. And we sort of are expecting that as the dialogue with the legislature goes forward, that we'll be sort of revisiting that and being more precise in it with the May revision.
Could you give us your analysis or comment on the alternatives that the LAO is presenting?
Yes, Senator. Several thoughts. First, the notion of sort of just continuing the single reduction, absent anything else, as the LAO suggested, the danger there is that we're simply going to continue to drift the state's work participation rate lower and lower, so that's on the one hand. And secondly, that means that there is this increasing population whom we're not trying to engage, we're not offering services to. And time is elapsing in sort of their opportunity to make connections and get what benefits services can provide them. So one has to be concerned about simply saying, let more time elapse. On the focusing the earned income disregard at folk with lower hours rather than higher hours, the concern I would have there, I mean, I understand the concept, is that it moves away from the notion of trying to say, how do we really create bonuses that reward people who find those extra hours of work, et cetera. And so I think that the intent is to try to find whatever ways there are to make that investment by the participant, make it a return to them and their kids. And inverting the priority, I have concerns about. Increasing sort of the severity of the sanctions is frankly something I think we've tried to stay away from for a long time, as is the notion of sort of setting some sort of lifetime limit for eligibility for the whole family. The whole family time limits or whole family sanctions, the experience that we've seen from research in other states is very mixed. It doesn't, there's no, we don't see anything that says that there is sufficient likelihood of changed behavior that benefits the participant or the program that, at least in my personal view, warrants the risks that are inherent in it.
With regard to the conversation I had with Mr. Euler regarding the retroactivity, at a very base level, that just seems completely unfair. And I know, you know we're looking at a few options here, but that one just stings.
I understand, Senator.
You're not in love with it yourself.
it's a budget numbers issue, and but let me leave it there.
And again, we'll be having much thorough conversations than this at the budget subcommittee. ably led by my colleague, Senator Sullivan, and I know he's got many thoughts on this as well. But if our target goal is $1 billion, or even if it's $750 million, whatever it may end up to be, I think there've got to be ways to do it without just snatching it, the carpet from underneath folks who thought they were playing by the rules.
As I said, Senator, we really want to look at the options and the alternatives that keep us moving the program in a way that helps serve people, helps them engage, and helps the state meet its obligations under the program.
One of the suggestions coming from the LAO is reducing the cash assistance after longer periods so that we could then help others who are currently in need, younger families, younger participants. Any thoughts on that?
It's an option, but I think the concern I was expressing before was that it sort of starts us down that path to sort of saying that there's ultimately a limit while children are still children. And the intent of the child maintenance program, although I realize that there are, you know, concerns with the grant proposal, the intent is to say that we're going to maintain the child well-being support for the very lowest income children in California regardless.
Yes, Senator Evans.
I have a couple of specific questions.
Senator Evans and Senator Ryden and Senator Emerson.
Okay. First question is, our analysis is saying that there's going to, the proposal with respect to child care within the CalWORKs program will result in 62,000 children losing child care. Does that sound about right?
Yeah.
I'm wondering what those kids are going to do and what those parents are going to do and what the employers that depend on those parents are going to do.
It is a hardship, and it's created. Todd, you were going to.
I think that number is correct. We're going to be discussing child care in more detail later. There's a series of eligibility reductions, that the major one being essentially requiring recipients to be meeting the federal, even those who aren't part of our TANF program at all right now, to be meeting the federal work requirements if they're working sufficient hours. That would be how they would get child care, assuming they are under the 200% of poverty.
Question still stands, and nobody really has an answer what those kids and those parents and those employers are going to do. And I just want to make the observation, we're looking at this right now in terms of just dollars, but these are jobs.
Yes.
And it's not just a human interest problem, it's an economic and a business problem when parents can't get child care and can't get to work. I mean, think of everybody we rely on here in this room who have children. If they suddenly disappeared, we couldn't function. So this is true of businesses as well. And so from that standpoint, I think we need to think about that.
I think the prioritization that the governor is seeking here is to essentially focus it on the families that are working and less on and make it make essentially ineligible those that were focusing on educational goals rather than work.
Wow, that has
other trade-offs
slope
as well now.
When you're talking about not being able to educate people, you are also talking about them no longer having an ability to work. The same analysis, and I'm looking at the introduction on page 2 in our analysis. The savings that are attempted to be achieved, general fund savings, would be $1.4 billion by all of these CalWORKs cuts, including the child care cuts. The question that I want to ask is, and my recollection of the dollars is that every dollar we put into the CalWORKs program results in another $10 to $11 of local economic activity, which would then result in some percentage of that coming back to the state in terms of state revenues. Now, maybe my dollars are off, but it's undeniable that there is economic activity that can be measured by every dollar we spend on the CalWORKs program as well as other programs. My question is whether or not you're building the loss in state revenues into the assumed savings to the general fund.
Senator, maybe
where is that factored in?
Perhaps let me address that from two points. I have not seen, I'm trying to remember if I've seen a specific multiplier calculation for the CalWORKs.
There is one. I just
grant. The one that I recall is for actually the CalFresh benefit, which I think is $1.70 or $1.72 is the multiplier effect, which is significant. And you know, I've been part of making sure that policymakers are very aware of that benefit. There is, when we do our budget assumptions, there is an offsetting assumption that says the portion of the sales tax that would have been achieved from that as lost revenue is, I'm not sure if it's in these estimates or it will be in the later, but I'm looking at finance, will be in the later budget documents, but we will have to offset for it.
Okay, well, when we have those figures, I would very much like to see what they are. I don't think that's an insignificant consideration. And then there's a specific program that I'm extremely concerned about. That is the CalLEARN program.
Yes.
And I understand that was suspended last year, and it's proposed to be eliminated this year. And it's a program that takes care of pregnant and parenting teens. Teens,
yeah.
Not adults, teenagers. This would be women. I can't think of too many men that get pregnant in their teenage years. These would be women. So what's going to happen to these women?
To clarify, Senator, what is proposed for elimination is the case management services component of the funding. The aid continues to the pregnant teen or the parenting teen. The bonuses, which are currently paid for school attendance, passing grades, et cetera, are still funded and still continue. The specialized case management that was originally built back in the origins of it on the Adolescent Family Life Program casework model, those are the services that are discontinued unless the county is opting to continue them.
But aren't those the services that actually tend to reduce teen pregnancies?
They may very well do so, Senator.
I think that was, yes, their intent.
I mean, historically what the CalLEARN program has accomplished is both maternal health issues, reproductive issues, and also very importantly, remaining engaged in education, completion of high school, et cetera.
So